This morning we're continuing in our series that is based on the Sermon on the Mount. We're calling it The Best Advice I Never Took. And advice, of course, in quotations there, because we understand as followers of Jesus, what Jesus taught there is not just advice, it's commands for our life. It's how we need to live as his followers. And this morning we're going to see what Jesus had to say about material wealth and about being generous. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn to Matthew chapter 6. We're going to be starting in verse 19, and there we find Jesus teaching this. He says, "Don't store up treasures here on earth, where moths eat them and rust destroys them, and where thieves break in and steal. Store your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust cannot destroy, and thieves do not break in and steal. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will also be. No one can serve two masters. For you will hate one and love the other, or you will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money." You know, greed is, or can be, a really deceptive sin in our lives. And one of the reasons it can be so deceptive is because it's really good at hiding itself. In fact, as I was reading those verses, you may have been thinking, you know, finally we've come to one in this series that I don't have a problem with. You know, I can kind of check that one off. At first we talked about reconciling broken relationships. Yeah, I struggle there. And then the next time we talked about forgiving others. And yeah, I know I have problems there. And then we talked about not worrying last week. And we all struggle with that. And finally we've come to one. Oh, thank goodness. I don't have a problem with greed. Now come to think of it, I have never met a greedy person. Have you? And by that, this is what I mean. I've never met a man or woman who has looked me in the eyes and said, "I struggle with greed." Have you ever said that to anybody else about yourself? I doubt it. I doubt we have. You know, the truth is, in many ways, we have made it almost impossible to identify greed in our own lives. And that's because, like I said, greed is good at hiding itself. And in fact, greed likes to hide behind what we consider to be many virtuous things. And they are virtuous things. You know, those who struggle with greed oftentimes are often very good savers as well, and saving is a good thing. Those who struggle with greed are also often good planners, and planning is a good thing. Those who struggle with greed can also be people who want to make sure their financial future is secure and that their kids are not going to be burdened with having to take on the whole responsibility of caring for them in their latter years. Is that not a good thing as well? I believe it is. But that's where greed can sometimes kind of hide behind some of those virtues. You know, greed also isn't just a rich person's problem. There are greedy poor people. There are greedy rich people. Greed is not just a financial issue, it's a heart issue. You know, honestly, when you peel back all the layers here, when you peel back all the layers and get to the core, fear is really the driving force behind greed. Greed is supported by this endless list of what if. What if it gets scratched? What if it gets broken? What if it gets stolen? What if there isn't enough? What if I don't get my fair share? What if they get more than me? What if the economy collapses? Now, when we struggle with greed, we fear that God either can't or won't take care of us. And I think maybe a better way of saying that is, we're afraid that God won't take care of us at the level, style, and comfort that we want to be taken care of. And the gap between what we think God might do or might provide for us and what we want can oftentimes be pretty far apart, and because of that can provide a lot of worry in our lives. And we talked about what worry can do to us last week. So when we struggle with greed, I think one of the common factors here is when we struggle with greed, we set out to acquire everything we think we need in order to provide the sense of security and comfort we think we cannot live without. But like all human appetites, the appetite for financial security or just peace and security solely through material wealth, it can never be fully satisfied. It can never be fully satisfied. There's never enough. There is always some scenario, there's always some circumstance that we can imagine or come up with in which something more will be needed, or something better will be needed, or something bigger will be needed. About 12 years ago, the U.S. News and World Report did a national survey to try to find out what it was that people needed to feel financially secure and satisfied. And as they began this survey, they went to American households that made an average of about $25,000 a year. And they asked them this question. They said, how much money would it take a year for you to feel financially secure and satisfied? And the average answer from amongst those households came back that it would take $54,000 a year for them to feel financially secure and satisfied. So they moved on to the next group of households and those that made an average of $100,000 a year. And they asked them the same question. And the average answer that came back from those households was that it would take $192,000 a year in order to feel financially secure and satisfied. So in other words, the so-called American dream lies twice the financial distance from where you are right now, no matter how much money you make. Think about that. Think about that. You see, it's never enough. It's never enough. Ecclesiastes 5:10 says, whoever loves money never has enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income. But as I was thinking about this and was reading the teaching of Jesus and reading some of these other passages that deal with this, I began to think to myself, doesn't the Bible also talk about the virtue or the goodness of planning for life's eventualities? Aren't there scriptures that talk about the importance of saving, or the importance even of investing? Yes, there are actually. When you look at the Old Testament books of wisdom, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, they talk about those things, the goodness of those things. You know, one of the Ten Commandments that God gave to Moses would not have been don't steal if it were completely wrong to acquire things or to possess things. The commandment to not steal from others assumes you're going to possess things. You're going to have possessions. And so because of that, because of the things that talk about the goodness of saving or investing and doing some of these things, but also being careful of the greed that Jesus talked about, this is where it can be difficult to kind of pin things down on this topic. So how are we to understand the teachings of Jesus on greed that we've read this morning? Well, as Jesus often does, he's this masterful storyteller. And what he often does is he would tell a story that illustrates the principle that he's just taught. And that's what he does in the Gospel of Luke. So we're going to jump from the Gospel of Matthew over to the Gospel of Luke, where Jesus is teaching on these same issues. And this is what we see him teach there. He says, watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. And then he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, what shall I do? I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, this is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves but is not rich toward God. So this wealthy landowner whose property produced more than he expected, certainly, and definitely more than he needed for himself, he doesn't have this place to store this huge harvest. He's got this problem. And so maybe he's kind of thinking to himself, what am I going to do with all my stuff that I have a result of all my hard work? Now, in an agricultural society like this landowner lived in, it would be immediately obvious that the abundance of this man's harvest, honestly, had very little to do with just his hard work. Farmers are always at the mercy of factors and circumstances which they have no control over, but on which their harvest is completely dependent on. Many of you here who are farmers, you understand that better than anybody else. But this landowner doesn't seem to see the world that way. What comes their way does so because they deserved it, because they earned it by their own talent, by their own sweat, by their own hard work. And since this landowner seems to believe he earned this abundance, he doesn't seem to consider the idea, at least in what the story Jesus tells, that God's hand was involved in it, that God's hand was behind the blessing that he had in this abundant harvest. And even if he had taken the time to give God credit for giving him this amazing harvest, it never seems to cross his mind that the extra he has been blessed with is intended for anybody else's consumption but his own. Clearly, God has provided this guy with extra. The question he should be asking is, Lord, what do you want me to do with my extra? What do you want me to do with what I have? What do you want me to do because you've given me more than I need? Just for fun, I'd like us to say this together, this phrase right here. You ready? Lord, what do you want me to do with my extra? But again, that's not typically, as we struggle with greed, that's not typically how we think. Like the landowner in the parable, we can always come up with a plan for the extra, right? I mean, that's not hard. I mean, that's easy to do. And that plan usually assumes that it's just for us. That it's just for us. You know, I believe one of the real morals of this story that Jesus is teaching is this, that those whose eagerness to store up material goods outpaces their willingness to give or to be generous will suffer a complete and total loss when their time runs out. Now, I don't mean in reference to salvation here, but a loss of many important things. You know, the landowner suffered a total reversal of fortune at death. He didn't just lose his life. He lost everything he considered to be life because his life consisted in just the abundance of his possessions. He was rich in this world, but Jesus said he was poor towards God because everything that came his way, he assumed, was just for him. So I think here's a question we all need to ask ourselves regularly as we think about this area. Lord, why do I have so much, or why do I have what I have, and what do you want me to do with the extra? Now, I realize you probably don't have as much as you want. Few people would say that they have as much as they want, or maybe even need in some cases. Again, the desire for stuff is just like the rest of our appetites. It can never be fully satisfied. But just for a moment this morning, I'd like you to do something. I'd like you to try to shift your focus away from potential possessions or potential income, you know, what you hope for or what you could have, and think more about your actual possessions and your actual income. Now, I know it's not true for everybody here this morning, especially in a group this large, but chances are, if you think that way, if you try to focus on what your actual is, chances are it's more than your parents had at your age, is it not? I think for most of us that would be true. And there's absolutely no doubt it's more than most people in this world could even begin to imagine. So why you? Why me? Why do we have what we have? I think we need to slow down and force ourselves to wrestle with that question, because a consumer-driven culture like ours keeps us laser-focused on what we don't have, on what we should have, and what we absolutely can't live without, and we gotta buy. That's just the culture we live in. And if we are constantly focusing on what we don't have, or what we should have, then we are making our hearts vulnerable to greed to take root. As long as I am on a constant quest for more, then when more does come along, I'm automatically going to assume it's for me. So again, let me ask you, why do you have what you have? The greedy landowner seemed to believe that he deserved it, didn't seem to recognize God's hand involved in it, and pretty much assumed, from what Jesus was describing, that it was all for him. So assuming that we aren't as short-sighted as him, let's ask the question this way. Why has God provided you with more than you need? Again, I know everybody here this morning may not be there right now in your life, but I believe many of us are. Why has God provided you with more than you need? You know, in the past, maybe there was a time when you didn't have enough. Maybe it was when you first got married and you were just starting off, and many of you have experienced how tight things can be at that moment, maybe living off one salary or not even a full-time salary. Maybe you went through a time where you got laid off from your job, or you took a tremendous salary cut, or there was this huge unexpected expense in your life. And so things were really tight. I mean, they were really tight. Not even just paycheck to paycheck, maybe even worse than that. And in those moments, did we avoid asking God for help in those moments? No, we didn't. And rightfully so, we lifted our concerns to God. We lifted those things to God and said, God, please meet my needs in this area. And when he did provide, in whatever way he chose to provide for you, when he did, what did we do? We were thankful. And we're thankful people, and we were thankful for God meeting our needs. Maybe even we went out and we told other people the story of how God provided for us, hoping it would be an encouragement for them, hoping it would help them to trust God more, say that, rely on him, trust in God, he will provide. So now that maybe you're on the other side of that, you're not in that same situation anymore. You're in a more comfortable situation in which you have enough, and in many cases you have more than you need. Let me ask this question. Why don't we ask God about why that is? When we don't have enough, we wonder why. But we don't tend to wonder why when we have more than enough and what the purpose behind it might be. You see what I'm saying? Why is that? And I believe a very simple answer is that it's greed. Some form of greed. We all struggle with it. We all struggle with it. So why has God provided us with more than we need? What are the possibilities? What might God be up to in providing more than just our daily bread? I mean, we could all go home and look at our refrigerators and our pantries and know, I got plenty more than just my daily bread, and God has blessed us. Well, maybe God provided us with more than we need so that we don't have to worry. Maybe he wants us to lean in on our wealth, our possessions, for peace and security. But I got a feeling you're kind of like me, and that's probably not the reason for it, right? This next scripture that comes up is actually from Proverbs. I've got the wrong reference there. But in Proverbs, the writer says, two things I ask of you, Lord. Keep falsehood and lies far from me. Give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Otherwise, I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? Or I may become poor and steal and so dishonor the name of my God. Proverbs 30, 7 through 9. Now, generally speaking, the more a person accumulates, the more they tend to worry about it, because you got to worry about maintaining it and upkeeping it and protecting it and all these other things. It consumes a lot of our time, thoughts, and energy. And peace. Peace is a fruit of the Spirit. It's not the result of wealth and possessions. It's not God intends those things for us to lean on those things for peace and security. I mean, think about it. Wealth and possessions didn't seem too peaceful and too secure when the stock market crashed in 2008, did it? And many of you saw your 401ks right through the floor. Wealth and possessions are very fragile things. So maybe it's not that. So maybe God has provided us with extra in order to elevate our standard of living. Maybe take it up a notch or two from where it is right now. I mean, that seems to be the American way, right? I mean, in this country, we all enter into adulthood with the assumption that our lifestyle is going to keep pace with our income, that there's not going to be too much space between those things, and they kind of keep pace with one another. In fact, thanks to the credit card industry, for many Americans, their lifestyle slightly outpaces what their income is. Either way, we are constantly urged not to allow one to lag too far behind the other, that there's not too much space between the two. And the result of all this, and there's a key word here, the result of this is artificial financial pressure in our lives. Artificial financial pressure. Now, a lot of people will say, artificial? My financial obligations don't feel very artificial to me, Eric. And if I don't meet those obligations, what happens to me is not going to be very artificial either. And that's true. They don't feel artificial because the costs associated with maintaining the lifestyles that we have chosen, another key word, we have chosen to live, they are very real. We do have to pay our premium cable bill, our unlimited high-speed internet access, our unlimited cell phone data plan, our Netflix and Hulu subscriptions, all of our credit card bills. Now look, I don't mention those things specifically to demonize them. I'm not saying you're a bad person if you have any of those things. I'm not trying to say if you're a real Christian, you'll buy this. If you're not a real Christian, you'll avoid. It's not what it's about. The point is those bills exist because we have chosen to lead a lifestyle that keeps pace with, or in many cases outpaces, our income. We've convinced ourselves that all those luxuries are necessities, things that we absolutely cannot live without. So in many ways there's this unrealistic sense that these are essential things. They're essential financial pressures, but they're really artificial. And maybe all we need to do is just kind of throttle back a notch or two. And maybe we'd find that life becomes much easier than it may be right now. Now look, I understand that debt is a serious issue for many, especially in this country. And I would recommend, if you would like to find ways you can throttle back there and create some more peace in your life because of that, Dave Ramsey's book, The Total Money Makeover, based on many biblical principles about how God wants us to view these things. So there's a copy of that at our Faith at Home Center that you can check out. You can order that book anywhere, but I'd recommend that if you're looking for a way to get out from under that kind of enslavement to debt. But you see, where there is no margin, where there's no margin financially between our lifestyles that we choose to live and the income that we have, there's almost no way to avoid greed. There's almost no way to avoid it. When the financial pressure is on, we don't have much of a choice but to think of ourselves first. And is that not the essence of greed? To think of only oneself, to think of oneself first before anything else? We don't actually have to have a whole bunch of extra to be greedy. As long as we plan to spend whatever comes our way on ourselves, we're cultivating our hearts for greed to take root. And the only surefire way to fight greed in our hearts is to be generous. Remember, going back to something Jesus said earlier that we read in the Sermon on the Mount. He said, wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will also be. And I'd like you to think about that this way. If everything that comes our way, we kind of assume is for us, and we basically spend it on us, then that's where our hearts are going to be. Our hearts are going to follow where much of our treasure is and all the things that we possess and gather around us. Like I said, it consumes so much of our time in having to clean it, maintain it, all these other things that are associated with it. But if a significant, I'm not saying you give everything away, but if a significant amount is given to meet a need of someone else or to support a Christian work somewhere or to support a missionary overseas doing kingdom work, then isn't the same principle true that our heart will begin to follow towards those things and be concerned with those things instead of just what we accumulate for ourselves? Because we have invested a significant amount of our treasure there. And we'll be concerned with those things. That's a good thing. We're not thinking just about ourselves. We're thinking of other people. We're thinking of the work of God taking place in the lives of others. Being generous with our money, our time, our resources is one of the key ways God changes our heart and grows us spiritually. And as our heart begins to change, our attitudes, our feelings will follow that. You know, the Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. Here's the thing. He will put our money to good use whether we're cheerful about it or not. So my advice would be, give until you get cheerful. Give until you get cheerful. Make the choice and commitment to be generous. And feelings and those other things will follow in time. Here's another thing about being generous. I believe our giving must impact our lifestyle. I really do. I believe our giving must impact our lifestyle. If it's going to break the power of greed, on some level I do believe we need to feel it. If we don't even have to think about it, if it doesn't even really affect us at all, I don't know how good of a job it's going to do at breaking greed in our life. And I think a couple of the best ways, practical ways to do that, is to be a percentage and spontaneous giver. Greg, we've talked about these things before in stewardship series that we've done, but percentage giving basically involves giving away a percentage of everything you receive right off the top as soon as you get it. Specifically, the first check you would write after depositing your check in the bank would be a check to support some Christian organization, a missionary, some work of God, whether it be in the local church or across the seas, supporting God's kingdom in that way. Writing that first check for that makes sure that God's kingdom is funded ahead of our own, that God comes before any of our desires and any of our wants. And I believe that's a good practice. Now, if the idea of percentage giving is scary to you, if that's never been a part of your pattern or a habit in your life before, start with a low percentage, 2%. You may not even feel that as you begin to do that, but it'll make it a habit in your life to begin to do those things. And eventually you'll find yourself giving a significant amount of what God has given you to help others. And it will make a lifestyle adjustment for you. But I also want to talk about this idea of being a spontaneous giver. You know, James, the brother of Jesus, wrote this. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by action, is dead. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. Now, if we have what is needed to meet a spontaneous need that crosses our path during the routine of a normal day, we have what is needed to meet that need. We need to meet it. And a lot of times that involves more than just throwing some money at it. A lot of times it's going to involve taking time to meet the need. And that's usually, honestly, I think we have a bigger problem there than giving the money to meet the need. It's taking the time to meet the need. Because we've got our to-do list and we've got our everything scheduled out just so, and we can't deviate from that. Jesus was the master at what we would call interruptions in his daily schedule in order to take time and meet a need. And James says if we have the ability to do so, and we don't, and we ignore it, or we walk away from it, he says that's sin for us as followers of Jesus. So we need to be ready to be spontaneous givers and meet those needs that we can meet as they come across our path. That'll help reorient. Practicing those things help reorient our mind so that the first reaction concerning wealth and possessions, material wealth, becomes, Lord, why do I have what I have? What do you want me to do with the extra? How do you want me to use it to bring you glory? Now, before we close this morning, I just want to make something clear. There tends to be two extreme positions on money amongst the Christian world or Christian community. One is that if you truly want to be like Jesus, then you need to be poor. That if you really want to be like Jesus, you need to willfully make the choice to be in poverty. The other one seems to be that if God is pleased with you, and you just simply had enough faith, then you would be completely healthy, you would have tons of money, and no problems in your life. Both of these are wrong. Both of these are misguided. There are plenty, plenty of godly poor and rich people in the scriptures that are held up to us as examples of obedience and faith in God. Having money is not wrong. Having money is not unchristian. And being poor doesn't automatically make you godly. The real issue is not knowing why we have what we have, never thinking about why we have what we have and what and how God might want us to use it. Whether we are the beneficiary of hard work, good business sense, smart investments, a family inheritance, or just plain luck. Whatever the case, there is no reason to feel bad about having money, because it's not ours anyways. It's not ours anyway. It's simply on loan from God. If we're going to leave it all behind when we die, which is what Jesus described in the parable of the rich fool, then one thing's really clear. We're not owners. We're managers. And whether you think it's fair or unfair, God and His sovereign plan allow some people in this life to manage more than others. But none of us are owners. And as managers, we should never have a reason to feel guilty for what we've been given to manage. We should not feel guilty about it. We should feel responsible. We should feel responsible and being responsible to God with it. In Luke's gospel, Jesus concludes this section there, teaching on wealth, possessions, and greed with these words. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. And from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. Why don't you pray with me? God, we do thank you for your blessings in our life, for the way that you provide for our needs. As we've already studied in this series, Greg talked about worry, and Jesus said, look at God's creation and how God provides for that. If he meets the needs of birds and flowers in the field, will he not meet your needs? And Lord, we do know you provide for us. We thank you for that. Lord, we also know that you've gone above and beyond in many of our lives. We have more than just our daily bread. We have an abundance. I pray we never forget why that is, who it came from, who blessed us with that. And we never forget, never stop asking the question, why do I have what I have? How might God want me to use the extra that I have to serve others and to bring glory to Him? All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.